Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Artist State. My name is Iana Komarnytska and I'm joined by
Pedro Bonatto.
And in this show we explore all different aspects of creativity, art's life as a couple, and living out of art things. So, for everyone who is new, welcome to our show. For everyone who watched previous episodes already, welcome back. Thank you so much for leaving comments and your questions. Don't forget that you can always submit questions about any episodes and stuff related to what we are talking about via form at janadance.com/artistlife. I will include link.
Artist date.
Artist date. I will include direct link in the description to this video, so you can just click there. And also want to let you know that this show is brought to you by Iana Dance Club, which is our teaching platform, which will be interesting for everyone who likes dancing, specifically belly dancing and Middle Eastern and Near Eastern folkloric style. We explore a lot there. Link will be also in the show notes. And something tells me that today we actually will talk briefly about Iana Dance Club too, as a part of our artist life.
I think so.
So, what's up?
So what's up? Yeah, so first of all, besides thanking you guys for joining, if you haven't watched the previous episode where we interview Jesper and Cecile about the nomadic lifestyle and actually traveling with three kids and one dog and going around the world, actually.
And two big drums.
And two big drums, yeah. So, like, you should go check it out. It was a fascinating conversation. One of those things that it just happens. We were really not, even though, like, having kids and all that stuff is, of course, always on our minds. But, like, it was one of those interesting experiences of randomly finding this, like, Danish couple in this madrasa in Istanbul. And so anyway, I highly recommend people check it out. I was listening to it again yesterday, and it was a very fascinating take on education, very mind-bending ideas that I recommend people to check it out. And today we are in Turkey. We left
Istanbul
after like 2 weeks there. And we decided to go south, go to basically, I guess, this is already Asian side, right? It's already Asia, yes. It's already not part of Europe where we were mm-hmm. before in Istanbul. And we're in a city called Izmir, which is a very ancient city here. It has been occupied, I guess, for the last 8,000 years, as most places here in Turkey. And right now we are at this agora. We're actually at the basement of this agora, of this like town square, I guess, like that has been used since the Hellenistic times, right? So it has been used in by the Greeks, then later by the Romans, and then later by the Christians, and then by Muslim people, and now it has been transformed into sort of a museum. And you're very lucky and fortunate that, and I guess thanks to the Turkish museums for the opportunity to record here. And and I guess today, so this is where we are right now. And as maybe if you don't know, I'm a photographer and a musician, and Iana is a dancer. So when we travel, we like to create content together, both for like fun and promotion and all those things, but also to create, that's something Iana was mentioning about creating thing like content for the Iana Dance Club. So we record like this beautiful like classes, a 20-minute training session, sometimes like whole intensives in these beautiful places around the world. Please, we try to bring that kind of like level of visual quality to our content. And I think recording here, because yesterday when we were walking around, I guess I should let you talk about what you thought, and then I'll get into it.
It was funny because obviously, this is not a scripted conversations, but we only discuss like which topic Pedro wants to bring up and which topic I want to bring up. And then yesterday, when you said, first of all, we were planning to actually today to go to Ephesus, which is also a very known ancient place. But then we came in the morning here and we were doing some creative dance videos for my social media. But also like the vibe and your idea of, oh, maybe we should stick around here because this is our last day in Izmir. Tomorrow we already go to somewhere else. And use this, like, you know, vibe of very calm and very, I mean, obviously it's one of the biggest sight scenes in Izmir, but it's not that crowded, like, touristic place that it's always like a lot of people. And I'm pretty sure once I said it, you'll have a lot now coming during this recording. But to have this idea of recording just, you know, like a talk, like artist date here was very interesting. And when you also mentioned which topic you want to bring up, I was thinking, like, I'm like, oh my God, mine is so similar, because what I wanted to bring up is actually the process of preparing for shoots and from the angle of learning process. Because what basically happens, we have a bunch of different like types of shoots, like this is one, the recording for artist date. We have educational shoots that we record dance videos for Iana Dance Club, sometimes for YouTube, some small tips too. Then we have more creative dance videos that is more for social media. That's what we were yesterday recording here, and check my Instagram because I will be posting a lot soon from specifically Turkey videos. But also you have your own project. It's basically the topic you will bring up later today in this conversation. But also for me, we have a photo shoots. So I'm not only shooting videos, but for social media especially, I'm shooting photos. And the reason why I wanted to bring up, because this was the topic of this week, we finally start actively like shooting and preparing to shoot. Because first 2 weeks in Istanbul, it was just to look around, meet people, figure out what we are doing here. But now, since we are heading like to Izmir, now we are here, then we are heading to Pamukkale, to Cappadocia, and this will be very intense 2 weeks of shooting. And it's already on my mind to plan. So I kind of wanted to talk about the process of preparing for shoot while you are in unknown place. So you haven't been in that place, you don't know what exactly will happen, but as a blogger, I guess, too, like, you kind of need to figure out what will look good. And photos for me, they don't come natural. It's not like I'm not a photo model, I don't consider myself a photo model. So there are a couple of poses that, okay, I kind of know, but to make it very, that's not very natural for me. So I know my process of preparing for photo shoots, it has a different stages. First of all, it's choosing locations, or if I know exactly which location we are gonna go in the city, I always check on social media or on Google, like how it looks visually. Because that will give me idea of which outfits to use, not only from color palette, but also gives me idea of vibe, like either dance-wise I want to record something, or photo-wise what I want to record. So that comes like the first step. And then I typically also know in my wardrobe, because right now we are traveling, I don't have any single costume with me. So although I'm a dancer and we're doing a lot of shoots, they're all like creative but inspired, more like a mixing of I would say everyday lifestyle and dance together, and in these sometimes very ancient places. So how it all put together, so visually it looks interesting. So first of all, it's like checking how the place look, but then I go and usually check potential, let's say, poses. I'm not talking about dance videos right now, I'm talking about specifically photo shoots, which for me I feel a little bit more difficult. So that usually brings me, I have a folder on Instagram, like those saved folders, that whenever I scroll Instagram, scroll social media, and they say, oh, this photo is cool from anyone, like either on Explore or on my feed, I typically save it, and I usually later try to think what I like there. And in most cases for me, it's about pose. So then I use this folder as my reference. So whenever I'm preparing for the shoot, I go to that folder and scroll. Oh, something like this would be cool in that place that we are going. Oh, I have like similar outfit in terms of like, oh, this is like pants and I don't know, loose blouse. Because if I like the pose and it's in like super long flowy skirt and I don't have this dress, obviously that pose will not work for me, etc. So it's kind of choosing getting inspiration from other people. But here is where sort of creativity comes, because I'm not there are two kind of conflicting topics here that we can talk about. One is copying exactly, which is of course not like it's plagiarism, which is in dance, of course, we're talking as a dancer, like, oh, you cannot just copy someone else's dance. You cannot just go and learn from YouTube and then record and put it out. So it's a copyright of authors. And kind of in the photos, I have the same feeling that, like, if you exactly copy to the little details, like, oh, the same, I don't know, hat, and the same cup, and the same, etc., you're basically just copying it. And at the same time, if you take inspiration and you try to analyze, like, using it as a learning tool, because when we learn, we copy. When we learn dance, we copy teacher. When we learn, I don't know, singing, we also copy teacher. When we learn some, I don't know, woodcraft, we also copying teachers. So using it as a learning process brings up very different things, because sometimes, like, oh, you see the pose. I'm talking from my experience of, like, now struggling with, like, photo shoots. And I know that I'm not that bad. I can pose somehow. But still, like, to make sometimes, like, super, like, intricate pose, I don't feel it. That's also another, like, layer of it. What it visually looks and how you feel, it's different things. But sometimes using, like, the reference of photo, like, okay, how did it, why on the photo it works, and why if I was shot and I see on camera, and why my photo doesn't work at all. Like, looking at those nuances and going into the pose. And what usually happens while I'm trying to go into the pose, something else comes up. And then either you stop midway, like, oh, hold here, that was nice. Or I just start playing around, because some poses, they just don't feel natural for me. But I don't know, I was just thinking it's a very interesting, in my mind, topic of copying, but in a good way, not pretending it's yours, but copying as a learning tool, vice versa, copying as just ripping off and someone's creativity, let's say, and pretending it's yours.
Yeah, that's interesting. About the modeling thing, is interesting to, like, to see how much you've grown over time about, like, about posing, and how it's just a thing that happens with most people, that they're very self-conscious in front of the camera. And as a photographer, you see that almost all the time, unless you're working with a very experienced model. Even on the last recording, I was even thinking that we were having such a nice conversation, laughter, and as soon as you get ready to take a photo, people tense up, right? It's a very common problem with photographers. Like, so I think, like, you're way better than you think, but you're not at the level that you would like to be, which you see the final result of, like, certain people that you admire. And when you're talking about, like, Instagram, or, like, the people, the things that get suggested to us, they're basically the pinnacle of whatever the algorithms will think that we'll like. So it's already almost perfection, quote unquote, of what you want. And you want to suddenly, and it's stuff that you could even have stumbled upon it naturally doing, because whenever you see the process of making from those creators that you admire, you know, they have, and then as you see their things, you will see them, let's say, their go-to poses that they have nailed. Right? So that's something that happens a lot. And there is, of course, some, like, very iconic, very, let's say, very important, like, models that they were able to express, to make the process of modeling invisible, right? So they're basically expressing themselves, and then the photographer could go and capture whatever they're doing. For most of us, that process doesn't come that natural, at least it takes a while. But one thing that I noticed, like, for example, shooting with you, or shooting with models, or shooting with other kinds of people, they are, some model, if they are, like, I worked with a few models that were, like, amazing and did not have to, they knew what instinctively or by experience what she wanted, or what could be done in that kind of thing. But at the same time, they also have their go-tos, right? And I remember that I think it was Richard Avedon, one of the big, like, fashion photographers of the 20th century. One thing apparently that he used to do is that he would shoot with without film. It was in film times before digital, and he would shoot without film in the beginning because he did not want to waste it, because people were doing their poses that they would go to. And after the model got really tired, that's when he got some of the very iconic shots. So you have that mask like down. And he was trying to go with this idea of like fashion and authenticity and all those things. And in the Instagram world, when we go to certain places around here, you see like everyone going to try to do their like cute posy like things. And of course, on this note about like copying as being a sounding like other people, as Neil Gaiman said in one of his commencement speeches. I should put a link because that's a very cool one. That he talks about make good art, and he says about that, oh, over time you will sound a lot like other people. He's talking about the process of writing, but it was this idea of like you will sound a lot like other people on your process of writing until you find your own voice, right? Which, and I think for posing, especially like seeing for photography, comparing, let's say with posing with lighting, for example, the camera does not see what we're seeing. Also, the camera does not see what we're seeing in our imagination.
That's a different layer.
Yeah, but that's an important thing.
How many times, like, I feel like, oh, I'm so, like, relaxed, so, like, sensual. And then you, like, relax your face. And I'm like, but I am relaxed. I'm super relaxed right now. But, yeah, that's so funny how it's different things, what we see.
Yeah.
How it looks like, how we see like visually, and how we see on the camera.
And like about that, because the camera is that's one of those things that I was actually thinking about. I was not even going to bring this up, but it's actually related to this, which is what's the idea of reportage, right? So it's I'm reporting what I'm seeing and what I'm doing, which is one kind of photography, which I usually don't do, or I'm creating a world or creating a scene. And how much, to me at least, you have truth in the reportage part, but you also have truth in the fiction part, which is all those internal aspirations. How can I, in a photograph, in a two-dimensional collection of pixels of light, interpret internal like thought processes and emotions and all those things, right? So it's sort of like as much as we, let's say, whenever you're going, even the most let's say, I've seen this many times, like in journalism, like people, okay, I'm going to the house, I'm going to be super spontaneous. Yeah, but they clean their house first because they knew you're coming, right? So people always have this idea, and I don't see that as a bad thing. We have these aspirations of something better or something more beautiful that this way it doesn't work, but this way it does. And our goal of trying to find it, it appears like everywhere. And this idea of like copying, it's funny that we talk about this idea of copying here, specifically, because this place was used, built, rebuilt until there was like an earthquake, like 1800 years ago, like almost 2000 years ago, there was a big earthquake that really destroyed the infrastructure, so they could not really continue using it. But it was used for how many centuries? Through three or four or five different cultures, maybe more, in this place. And for example, you can see that with the Greeks that created so much stuff, and they actually borrowed a lot of things from the Egyptians and even Mesopotamians, right? And they always were like referential to the Egyptians. And then the Romans came, and then they basically copied even the gods, right? And and even the style of architecture, and the all the learned things were actually from Hellenic times. And I think that's something that we're always copying, but we can't help to make it our own, right? And with Instagram, like just to go back to from this ancient to this new thing, you think, for example, just to give an example of one photo that has been copied to death, the follow me photo,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
So it's like, you probably seen this in on YouTube, that you see someone from the background. You see?
You should do it too.
that it's like the girl, she has, she's seen from the back, and then she has her hand towards the back, and the photographer's basically holding her. So it's like this POV of the photography, point of view of the photographer, and he's holding her hand, and he's being taken by her to usually like a beautiful location. I can't remember the name of the photographer that first came up with this idea, and then, but I'll look it up to try to put his name here so you got credit or credit is due. And this idea was so cool that people decided, it became a language. It became a language. It became something that you do. This, you, before Instagram, there was the Kodak moments, right? So you had these times where they used to say, "Oh, here, if you pose here, if you do this pose, if you're doing this thing, like holding the the Pisa's tower, oh, as if it's falling, you know, like things that people started doing and imitating. But there is something to be said about the intention of the imitation. And mm-hmm. I think that's in the Western world, we have a lot that like ideas are property. And the idea of copyright is ideas are property. And but then it's basically we say this kind of idea is property, but this other one is not. Right, and how many layers are you going to do? Yeah. Like, we don't know who made this, for example, this place.
Yeah, there is one thing that you said that I kind of disagree, just coming from experience of like dancers, that oh, we can't help but make it our own. And I think many dancers, especially in my field, like ballet dancers, if someone is watching, they will agree with me too, because how often, like in the competitions or even like on YouTube, like we see like, oh, but this is like copies of this famous dancer. So someone came up with their own style, they became famous or known for their individuality, and then people start copying, usually like starting or little imitating this dance like again. And then especially it's visible on competitions, that it's like one after another, and if it's a long competition, at some point like they all look the same, like there is no personality. Like, yeah, the dancers are the different, they might have choreographed them themselves, but they did not find their own way and style. And it just brought me, like, I don't know, I all analyze all my learning patterns. Like right now we are talking about learning posing and photographing, but of course from dance experience, like it kind of reminds me that. So it's not necessarily, it's also how you are using someone else's material to get inspiration and to get learning, because simply copying doesn't work. That's why I was talking, then I look at the photos sometimes, I literally analyze, oh, why it works here? Ah, this photo, the girl has a lot of like jewelry, cool, so it looks rich. My like bare arm sometimes, ah, it looks blah, like it doesn't work. Oh, here, like she kind of like twisted like slightly to the side, but hips to another side, like, you know, little twist. Oh, that's why it looks, mine, it looks straight. So it doesn't look like the shape or curve. So it's more from analyzing. And that's what a lot I also, again, I can't help but compare to my own field, because that's how I always say like students, you analyze, like if you're learning someone else's choreography, with permission of like teacher, choreographer, you can even perform it, but you analyze, like if you video record yourself and you're not happy, you literally analyze by details what's not working. Is it the step? Is it the placement of feet? Is it the arms? Is it like some technique? So it's more, because that's natural, like even kids and they're learning to walk, like they see adults walking, so they're trying to copy too, or like eating, or like all our mechanical, like natural things that we are learning from like being a kid to grown adult. It's basically copying the world around us, and at some point discovering and inventing something else, something new. But it's this like very thin line of how exactly you use this process to enrich your own activities.
Yeah, it's an interesting idea about what I meant, like you can't help but like make it your own, in the sense that you, so I don't think you're in disagreement, it's more like you can't help if you're really trying to express yourself. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like this, you can wear these masks to reveal, or you can wear masks to hide.
Yeah.
So it's the same idea with the choreography, and I was like thinking about this that you were saying, like, for example, how many times a person has done even exactly the same pose, and we see things as being a copy, but it's literally a different location, different person, different space and time. So how is it a copy? Is it a copy of the patterns that were created? It is a different person. It's not the first one. So to me, at least, I always thought, and we always like to, okay, this is my original idea, so this is original. But we forgot all the things we're copying to make that original thing, you know? For example, in photography, I copied how to, even though it's like a technique, let's say, how to, if I want to blur the background, I saw someone doing it, I saw what it was, and I'm using that technique. Yep. Am I so since I'm using that element of the technique, am I copying it? How zoomed in or zoomed out you have to be to say that something is a copy. And even when it is a copy, let's say if you're doing a, for example, in music, if you're doing a, it's actually, there is no right or wrong in this. It's just how you interpret it. And I think sometimes people try to actually, you know, like that idea of even thinking of like recording this in this ancient place. And then when we go into the subject of like that I wanted to bring up, is this idea of us wanting to have immortality in a way. Mm-hmm. Or even if it's not immortality in the sense, I will live forever, but something that is us, that either will be remembered or that can be identified as you in art. And I think that's where the obsession, in a good way, for artists to be original come from. It's like, oh, I don't want to be like anyone else. I don't want to be the one that copies. Let me be original. But then you forget everything that you're copying. For example, even the vocabulary, let's say, in belly dance, from my limited knowledge, but watching you and watching, I don't know, probably thousands of dancers at this point, but like at least hundreds, you know when the movement is being done, let's say, quote unquote, properly, or at least when it looks beautiful, right? And there are certain recipes that you can copy to make that thing look there. And then, of course, you can do one layer above it, which is make it your own. And it's interesting, like, for example, just the difference between dancers and musicians is that musicians are used to, and people are used to listening to music that, like, it's a cover of, I don't know, Led Zeppelin or whatever, right? And sometimes you want it to make as close as possible to the original song. To the point that in the Western music, in Eastern music, like in the Middle East and other places, they actually like to make it different, and they actually make a point of, okay, I'm playing this specific traditional song, but I'm making it in my own style, and the audience really appreciates you doing it in your own style. Whereas in the West, sometimes I remember seeing The Wall, the show, which is a great, fantastic show, but as we saw, like, I don't know, two or three times I watched it, and it sounds exactly the same. So you're copying yourself. So you were original in the 70s, but now you're just copying yourself. And to me, that's like, in music, it's okay for you to go and do your own. For example, the best interpretation of Toxic by Britney Spears is by this, I forgot the name of the band, but I'll put a link to it, because it's a beautiful, beautiful like song. But it's a beautiful version that the person did completely different, right? But it's still the song, so they're imitating, but on their own way, and so that's okay. But the other person that imitates, it's not. So. And there is also the level of mastery. It reminds me of Hilary Hahn. I guess I am disagreeing with you. like Hilary Hahn, she's a violin player. And she was asked in this TV show to do an interpretation of the first song that she learned in the violin, which is this, like, it's a very simple, like, I think even I know how to do it. It's like, tan, 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 tan. Like this very simple, like, song that people, it's the first song you learn in the violin. Like in the traditional methods. And this master, like a musician, goes, picks up the bow in the show, and she plays her version, super simple. I'm sure to her, it's the simplest thing you could probably do. It's probably very difficult not to add your hundreds of years of things, but she did this very simple thing. So she's copying herself, but it's not, it's completely original. If you have heard that the first time. So anyway, it's just something to keep in mind that you never know the layers of copying unless you want to sound like other people. So I always like to think of like the copying as, are you putting a mask to reveal yourself because you identify with that thing, or that is a goal, or that is something that you mean to aspire, okay, this is my version of this, or is this interpretation just me hiding because I want to seem like someone else?
Yeah, that's also a copying as a learning process, like what for, to pretend you already like super like, you know, like cool at this, or to use it as expanding your vocabulary of whatever it is, either movements in dance, or I don't know, chords in music, or poses in photo shoots. And I think I brought up, even this topic was on my mind, copying as a learning process, because there are some travel bloggers which I admire a lot, and they constantly share like their like process too. And I know like some people, they have like this images in their mind appearing. Like for some, like I guess composers, like they hear melodies. For dancers, we see dances in our mind, and there are some people who see photos in their mind, like can be photographers or can be models, for instance. So for them, it's like, oh, they know what they want. Oh, I want a chair in this field randomly, and then this kind of dress. And then they, because they have this image, they start finding props and outfits. Like for me, it doesn't come natural like that. Sometimes I have a mood or I have idea of outfit, but not the entire fort itself, that I'm trying to recreate what I see in my mind in this fort. And it partially comes from, like, let's say, creative outlets. Like, as I say, some people hear melodies, some people may hear photos, but it also, I feel, comes from experience. So for me, it's easier to find some reference. Oh, this is sort of like similar location to what I will have, or this is sort of similar outfit, and this is my starting point. So it's not like I am doing this exactly photo reproductive, but I will start from here, because even to get into this photo mood and relax, as you were telling, like in the beginning, it's the most tense. So it's the easiest for me way. I will start from here. I will try to go through this like pose or mood, and then I will let things naturally happen. Mm-hmm. And I think it's kind of like copying in order to expand what I call my posing vocabulary. So with time, it kind of goes, because I will not remember like a year from now, oh, I was really trying to do this pose. And it will not be exactly like the same, but some elements of it will stay in my body. Like I will remember like, oh, this little twist really works nice on camera, or like the arm here looks nice on camera. So I will kind of include this element in some other photo shoot, for some other photo, it will come naturally, not even me analyzing it. So it's kind of like what I think, in which sense I will agree with you, we can help to make it our own, but with time.
Oh,
if
you
keep learning, like putting, expanding, like getting inspiration, with time, we cannot help but make it our own.
Yeah, and it's, I think that's one of those things that people, like they used to, we as artists do that all the time as well, that you judge an artwork or something you created on its own, right? So if you judge it on its own, first of all, this again, it's a borrowed idea, I think, from like I heard, I think, from Jordan Peterson, that he was talking about that you're not one person, but you're this collection of people across time. And that's actually even because you are not who you are now, but you are the influence now, you're the influence on the future and on the past. And it's funny, interesting for us to say, I'll probably include a little clip of this here. Our first, my first idea of a project together with you, this is way before I even heard of Peterson or start thinking of Jungian terms about things, but I even told you, we should do this photo that is like every year we do like a different one that is on the same place, and it took us only 6 years to start doing that project. But I was thinking like how it would be to take one model and put her in the same background, and over time, seeing her interact with her previous selves, so your past self cannot know what's going to happen in the future, but your future self knows what you were doing then. So creating this, we did the first photograph in that series when you were in Kyiv at the beginning of the year. So soon the next one. But I was mentioning this so that we are this collection across time. And same thing with our artwork. So sometimes I remember some people come, especially when you're not an artist, you go, oh, this album is bad, this album is this, or in the case of me, oh, this performance was not good. But what is that performance in the context of the whole
arc of development? Arc of,
not only that, imagine this, for example, how many, especially us with like music, we basically play, like in our case, traditional music, and with our own spin, sometimes combining different ones and all that. And that's already, let's say, oh, that's the element of originality, right? But I think it always depends on how you zoom in or zoom out, because you can choose to play a specific song. For example, when we did one song that was about resisting, for example, the Ottoman Empire in Bulgaria, one of our songs in the Blue Dot Ensemble, and afterwards, a song that is a Zeybeki song, that is in Turkish style, that uses a beat that was used by the Ottoman like army, and now it's used only in art. So what would be the like what's we're copying, and even we're trying to do traditional songs, you're literally trying to copy as possible, and that's where the value is. Oh, you can do exactly, even the people that we met at the bazaar here, that they do, let's say, illuminated paintings, they have their own style. And the guy there that we are probably going to do insert a little video, but he's doing, let's say, illumination, which is a specific technique for painting mm-hmm. and for drawing here in the Middle East. And we found this beautiful little, in the little bazaar, this huge, beautiful
Hopefully
room.
Hopefully we'll record separate video, yeah? And then link here too, yes. Because it's worth so.
Yeah, but I mentioned this guy because, of course, he is borrowing from like specific traditions mm-hmm. and then he's doing his own thing, that he's doing like surreal elements in his paintings. They're related to that, and we value that thing. At the same time, we value the people that, when you go to that madrasa in Istanbul, which we're gonna come back to, where they're doing the paintings exactly how they were doing, what, 500-600 yeah. years ago. So in the end, I cannot help but mention Amirali, that is the director of the Aga Khan Museum in Toronto, that one thing that when we're talking about this idea of originality is that the only thing pure is the mixture. I wish I could take credit for that phrase. I actually, since I'll make sure, I'll take credit for the phrase. It's, he was the first one, and who knows where he got the idea from. That there is this mixture of ideas, and there will be things that will be our own, but...
And they are our own
at the end. Not only that, but what does it matter? If you're doing something that is beautiful, because mm-hmm. on this artistic interpretations, we're never looking at what the audience is looking. It's sort of like the most egotistic part of being an artist. You need it as your feel to be original and to express yourself. But what if it's the first time, for example, I remember listening to, let's say, Lama Badi Yathathana, one of the main like Arabic songs. It's very beautiful. And to the people that are in the world music scene, it's sort of like playing Gustami Magla, or which is from Serbia, like a song. They're sick and tired of playing that. It's sort of like playing She Loves You, yeah, 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 like that kind of stuff. So it's one of those things. But why would you? It's a beautiful melody, and the playing as people used to play hundreds of years ago is going to bring the audience to this different place, right? And so, in that sense, the copying. It's transcendental. Mm-hmm. It's just that in art, we're always trying to be the original. But there is something to be said, or even we're not there yet, but we're gonna go to Egypt soon, and hopefully, inshallah, as they say here, but we're going to go to Egypt, where for 3,000 years, they're basically doing art by the numbers. Meaning, you want to copy exactly for 3,000 years. I mean, of course, there are differences between the old kingdom and the new kingdom, and there are differences. But basically what Khufu and people like did in the old kingdom became the standard to which people would paint and do things. And that art, and today we admire that quote-unquote consistency, mm-hmm. right? So I guess this is a defense of copy in a way, because it's like, yeah, originality is cool, but if you haven't mastered the copying exactly, even in Ukrainian like patterns and things like that on paintings or on embroiderments.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, like the most beautiful ones are the ones that they basically look, if you go to a museum, they will look like the ones in the 1800s. And then of course, some people, they can do that and transcend. Mm-hmm. So I think this for an artist is something I haven't thought about before, but it's like for an artist, it's sort of like this idea that you want to combine both the best elements of copying things that work or that are beautiful or that are solutions to problems with your own infusion of your own contribution in a way. Although the act of copying is already original. Mm. Anyway, that's my artwork talk.
I was thinking like how to add like copying elements or copying a vision. Or maybe not elements, but I don't know, can't find the second word, but I think that's the difference that will lie between copying as a like useful tool and copying as maybe not something that at some points we should do and pretend it's ours.
No, of course, I would not get the traditional. I think it's sort of like you want to, just like in science, that in that way copying and originality is something that you want to build on top of previous knowledge. One thing that happens in science a lot is that you want to, let's say, say where you got that idea from, or you got that data from, so that the person can go and check it out, right? And so in that honesty, I guess that's the best way to, that it's the honesty on your approach. So for example, let's say right now, for example, I'm literally trying to learn the darbuka in Turkish style, for example. So I'm literally copying what. And the other thing is, like, if I try to be, okay, let me innovate and try to make it my own, I haven't mastered it yet. I haven't copied it enough so that my soul will be shown beyond the copying. So the copying is a fundamental part of what happens. The problem is when you cannot be original. That's the problem of oppressive societies, when, oh, no, you're not supposed to do it differently, supposed to be that way. So then you lock the art and the creativity, and that's not cool. And you see that all the time, even when people try to make their own, like in music, when you do, like, some people poo-poo the idea of, like, oh, fusion in dance or in music or, like, in those things, when everything that you're doing is, it was fusion at some point, right? So it was, for a while, traditional. And if it was for a long time traditional, it's very, very likely that it came from a very oppressive society. And why would you want to imitate that? And maybe you want to imitate that now because you know that we are not in that specific moment anymore, you know? So it's quite fascinating. I didn't know we were going to talk about that. But and I think that even just to close off, like, with what I got from this place, if we can even think about this in terms of imitating, which is me. I remember when I was like a kid and I was watching this National Geographic documentary, and they were basically showing this, I think it's called Australopithecus afarensis. It's one of our ancestors from 1.5 million years ago. Maybe the numbers are wrong. Don't quote me on that, but you can Google it. But they found the bones in Ethiopia of Lucy. It's the oldest humanoid. Now they found one that is older, but it's like the oldest, like, almost complete skeleton of this humanoid. And it's like this little thing. And they are not our direct ancestors, but we are one of the branches that came to us. And one thing that they were doing back then, before computers and everything, I swear there is a point to what I'm saying. They started doing this, because I remember this yesterday, they started putting this clay things on top of imitating muscles on top of skeletons of like how do you call it?
Face,
like, yeah, like the skull, and then putting eyes and then putting the skin and making, how would that person look like? Very interesting. And I remember being at what, 8, 9 and seeing this, and it actually ties up to yesterday about about copying. I was so interested as we were traveling in the city of, like, travel vlogging, this sort of, like, which is what sort of what we're trying to do here, of showcasing the art of exploring and creating at the same time, right? And we're getting better at, like, however to visually depict this or in audio format, in case people are listening in audio. But I was like, well, and I had this, I really like the images of you following the researcher or you following the photographer, following the artist. And I even said to Jan, oh, whenever you see me walking around, like, film me, or on purpose, okay, I don't know how to, should I walk normally here to portray the idea of exploring? Like, or should I have a crew around me? If I have a crew around me, it would be a different vibe, right? So even that, you're already copying something, but it's my thing. Right, so you're copying, let's say, one part of the vocabulary to make your own, right? So it's an interesting point. But for me, about copying, like, the idea that I had was this idea of the ancient and the new. And I mentioned this National Geographic documentary of recreating those people, because the project I have right now, even though I totally forgot about this specific, like, video on VHS from National Geographic that I used to watch when I was 9, I had this image, like, whenever you walk, let's say, in a place like this, and then you were looking at this ancient history, maybe there is a plaque somewhere that explains something, now there are audio guides, maybe there is a tour guide, and there's all these people around, but you really don't have a sense of the place unless you have a very active imagination. And now with movies or even video games that really reconstruct that place, like, there is that one, I shout out to that, Assassin's Creed Origins, for video game lovers, or if you're not a video game lover, you will love this because you can walk around the Library of Alexandria
It's very cool. It's like
beautiful. And all the artwork is like they got Egyptologists to actually go through all the elements. So you walk on the fields, you find hippopotamus, you find the crocodiles. It's fascinating. And that's sort of like virtual reality in a way, where you are taking elements of your imagination, of someone's imagination or of a collective, and putting it there. So what I decided to do as a test to something that, as this idea of like copying, like I was, or our collaborations together to get out of the copying idea a little bit in terms of original. Mm-hmm. I think already talked about that a lot, but what I was thinking was more like in our collaborations, besides creating like beautiful like dance videos or like all this other content around you that we're creating, usually our work inspire me for a series, or at least I ask you kindly to be my model so I can test out some ideas, right? So for example, I had this idea of recreating this combination of ancient places and ancient people, because usually you want to see the people, not just necessarily the architecture, and that's the element missing, and how it was before, mm-hmm. right? And I was thinking, why not combining this ancient, let's say, constructions like we have now, and putting a person in that space, and combining that with a 3D digital reconstruction of the place with, I'm still searching for like an artist to collaborate on that element, because I can't learn everything on my own. But, but like it would be cool to be like with someone, just like I don't do the makeup myself on models, like you collaborate with different people. But this idea of computer generated images that are representative, today they're good enough for, if you do it correctly, they're almost indistinguishable for the real thing. Except that it's not grounded on the real thing. So that's why I wanted mm-hmm. to combine this idea of photography and the digital representations, and then to include either a person on the scene if you're on location, or do a composite. A composite is basically when you combine two images together that I shoot in studio with someone that will make like the costumes to be representations of what they were before. So to tie back just to this idea of copying, in a way, I am copying an image of ancient times. But at the same time, it's not, because it never really happened. So you're trying to be as faithful to history as possible with the knowledge that it's absolutely impossible, because you are not there. You did not capture those photons, mm-hmm. you know? So it's this active, but you're trying to be as original with your creativity and your imagination to help people imagine that place in a different light, something that maybe, not they would not be capable of, they would be capable, but that little extra aid of creating art inspired by antiquity combines those two things of originality and copying. And I think that was everything to do with what we're talking about in terms of creativity.
Yeah, but you're a person who, you do see images in your head.
Yeah.
Like you seek like the environment or like models, outfits according to what you see. And it just was yesterday when you mentioned, oh, you want to talk about this recreating, like the process of like taking ancient environment and like recreating, and also about the process of photoshoots. I kind of was like, oh, wow, that's that's funny, because I wanted to talk about photoshoot process too. So it was very interesting combination.
Yeah, it's very cool. So that's, I guess, where we are right now, like in terms of creating, me trying to create this new like series. So hopefully you guys saw some behind the scenes of the spot here where we are. We're very lucky to be almost not interrupted at all while we are in this beautiful
yes.
place. One of the advantages of, I guess, Greek constructions of at least the Hellenistic period in Turkey, right? Because sometimes we forget that this part of Turkey and all the way to Ukraine, it was dominated by Greek culture for like at some point, right? So you find ruins of these places. But I'm very excited to this idea of not only with Iana creating this, like, I think dance brings alive these ancient places, as when we recorded in Cyprus, when we recorded in other places. Like, you see an amphitheater, and tomorrow when you go to Pamukkale, like over the next few days, we'll probably record something and then put this video on the next one. But you see this amphitheater, and I always thought, oh, it's so sad that they don't have concerts here anymore. It's so sad. I mean, sometimes they do, which is
they
great.
They used in Anadolu Tasho, Fires of Anatolia, famous Turkish ensemble. They used to do, for many years, used to do shows in one of those ancient amphitheaters. But then I think the problem that they're facing is that because of this number of people and dancers and music and lights, so the place started it's very difficult to maintain it. So they close now, it's not happening. But I know like just many like 5-10 years ago, like it was still happening here a lot.
But it's just this thing, like I know that like we have beautiful, amazing theaters that are created and like art goes on. But seeing those places and thinking, oh, this was actually had a function.
Yeah.
You know, this actually was used. Like people fell in love with things. They like held hands. They sat down. They did all sorts of things there.
And now, sitting and chatting.
Yes. But now, of course, you have like whenever you go to those places, you can't help but be inspired by antiquity. And also, like at least to me, going on ancient places is one of those things that, to me, you get connected. Because we sort of like get, oh, what the president is doing these days, or like whatever, like things, thing you want to worry about now. But you remember that whenever you go to ancient places, you remember that, first of all, history was way bloodier and worse before, in a way. And sometimes way more grandiose and beautiful and maybe romantic at some points. And that's just a reminder that it is actually as romantic and beautiful right now, if you embrace life, you know. And I think, at least to me, when you go to these ancient places, is this idea that you can celebrate the beautiful new things that you can create based on that, right? Like when you go, when we did here, we're walking around and it's, oh, this cool spot here, right? So how about doing a little like dance video here? And I wanted to do a photograph, we'll probably insert here, that I thought, oh, like I thought it would be cool with the backlight this way. And then I thought, I want to dance here, so let's create a little like something. And I don't know, to me, this brings life to places, creating art in ancient places. And that's my project with like this recreation of combining 3D images with ancient like places in the actual spots. That I'm trying to do the pilot version like over here and over the next few days. But also, how can you make your experience of being not an observer in the space, but being an active participant, even if it is just sit down for a cup of tea and admire the place, and something that is more than just the flex on social media, oh, look at me having fun on this place, which is the worst kind of copying, if you think about what's going on right now all the time. At the same time, it's like people want, they sometimes have like, we have terrible lives, we have not like, we, our lives suck for a while, and we want to have some moments of sharing the nice like moments. I can't be too cynical about sharing beauty.
That's
and sharing,
for sure. Yeah, but it's also like the time what people have, because this is advantage of a long-term travel. Like we are not in a rush. We can afford like to sit an hour and just talk here. And actually, we came back here.
Yeah.
Like if not everyone can allow it, and sometimes people have very short periods of times and they want to see everything, because who knows when next time they will travel. So it's different also vibes and things. But it's interesting point, like bringing places to life is dance.
Yeah,
I like this.
Yeah, that's sort of what we're trying to do too, like having this images. So that's it for today. Thank you for joining me, Iana.
Thank you.
And guys,
you have no choice to escape.
try. No. Then we'd love to hear from you again. Like, don't be shy. Like, do comments on YouTube and ask your questions, or send us a question at ianadance.com/artistdate. You can find everything there. Please leave a like, subscribe to the channel if you'd like to see more. We're trying to put these episodes every Wednesday. Trying to, at least every week.
Every
we'll
week.
See a new web episode, trying for Wednesdays, but we'll see how it goes. I'm also working to put this as a audio platform, as a like audio podcast as well. So if you'd like to just listen to it, it will be available on.
But if someone is listening right now, I also recommend check YouTube, because sometimes we insert images of what we actually talking if you had them captured.
Yeah, we had this vision of being more of a conversation, but then even
we can't help.
Yeah, we need to put. And my mom was saying like, oh, please put photos and videos to make more interesting. Like, okay, you're saying your son is not interesting. Huh? Sure. Yeah, no, but so anyway, thank you for being with us. You can find me on most social media at Pedro Bonatto with two T's and Iana with...
My social media is Iana... _dance with I. Also, we'll add links to the description of the video. And of course, don't forget to check Iana Dance Club. We talked a lot about it. And you know what's the funniest thing? While we were talking, I realized, oh wow, actually, we are in the beginning of intensive at the Iana Dance Club, which is learning choreography in details with me. So during the intensive, I actually will be talking a lot about using the benefit of learning someone else's choreography for your own creativity too, and expanding your vocabulary. So I just thought, like, you know, like the ideas, they just like spin somewhere in the air and then they go into all different directions. We just talked about this and I was like, oh, it's literally the time at the Iana Dance Club, sort of not photoshoot copies, but still like using this experience of learning choreography. So check it out at ianadanceclub.com. Links also will be in the show notes. And I guess on this note, we can wish you all the best. And yeah, we will see you very soon next time from somewhere else.
Probably.